Who is the King of Kings?
Jesus!
Who is the Lord of Lords?
Jesus!
Who is God in heaven?
Jesus!
Who is God on earth?
Jesus!
Who died on the cross?
Jesus!
Who rose again?
Jesus!
Who is in heaven?
Jesus!
Who waits for you and me?
Jesus!
Who wants to bring you home?
Jesus!
Is that thing?
Jesus!
Is that thing?
Jesus!
See, now you say Allahu Akbar. I say Yahweh! Hua Al Akbar!
Jay restricts himself to Yahuwah Elo Yahuwah Ahud. Yes? You take that and you find Hua Elo Hua Ahud. Kul Hua Allahu Ahud. Say, your Lord is one. I invite you to Islam and come to the right path instead of the respectfully confused way. Thank you.
Takbir! Isn't it interesting that he says it would be odd for God to come to earth? That would be odd for God to come to earth. I agree, it would be odd for God to come to earth. Are you suggesting that God cannot come to earth? Please don't say that in my presence. If your God cannot take on human form, you don't have God. Your God is too small. If your God is incapable of coming to earth and taking on human form, what kind of God do you have? Get a bigger God. Come on home, we've got him. And his name is Jesus. Yes, my God, he can come on earth anytime he wants. And every time he came to earth, and he did right through the Old Testament, that was God who was talking to Moses in Deuteronomy. We're having a debate. That was God right through the Old Testament. That was face to face with Moses. My God can come to earth from the very beginning. He was in the Garden of Eden, talking with Adam and Eve, walking and talking in the cool of the day.
Your God is not that powerful. Words to that effect. He cannot come down as a man. Well, actually, I had mentioned a goat. So I would want to know, is it possible for his God to come down as a goat? If the answer is no, there is a serious problem here. And I don't mean this in a flippant way at all. Yes? Because if his God is big enough, then he can come down as a goat. And if that is the case, Jay should not have a problem, just a slight diversion here, Jay should not have a problem at all in considering God coming down as a cow, or as a horse, or as anything else. I know Jay will not accept that, nor will all my Christian brethren. It is impossible to conceive of something like this.
The question, who is God and is Jesus God? Now the question has come up many times here at Speaker's Corner. We've always had this question that's come up. Where does Jesus ever say, I am God? Muslims then say, where does he say, worship me? Jesus doesn't say, I am God, worship me. But does he ever say, I am God? Yes, he does. And the best place to look for that is John chapter 8, verse 58, which we had a discussion about a month ago. In John 8, 58, it's very clear that Jesus is talking about Abraham. And he's saying earlier in the verse 41, that Abraham did not want to kill me. He's talking to Jews. He's in the temple. Therefore, he's talking in Hebrew to the Jews in the temple. In verse 56, he says, your father Abraham rejoiced at seeing my day, which means he was talking with Abraham. And of course, the Jews got upset. And they said, how can you talk about speaking with Abraham? You're not even 50 years old. And Jesus responds in verse 58. Before Abraham was,
I am.
I am.
Yeah, but God told
in the Greek, it is ego eimi. That is the clearest reference we have of Jesus saying, I am God. John 8, 58. Now when he said that, of course, look at the reaction of the Jews. The Jews took up stones as if to stone him. And he walked away. And he hid from them. It says there in John 8. Why did the Jews pick up stones to stone him? Because they knew that he was claiming God's holy name. Ego eimi is the Greek translation of Yahweh. or Ehyeh, Asher Ehyeh, which comes from Exodus chapter 3, verse 14. The first part of Exodus chapter 3, verse 14. Ehyeh, Asher Ehyeh. See, that's the phrase that God gave to Moses in 1400 BC. In 1400 BC, God was asking Moses, he was there, he appeared in the burning bush, and Moses was going to go down to Egypt, and he wanted to know the name of God before he went down, so that the Israelites who were in captivity there in Egypt will know which God he represented. And that's why he said, Ehyeh, Asher Ehyeh. Tell the people there that it is me, it is I am who has sent you.
Amen.
And in verse 15, he repeats the word again, Yahweh. This is the third person singular. Ehyeh is the first person singular. So now we get the third person singular, and he said, and this shall be my name forever from generation to generation, which means it's still God's name today. And it's the name that all the prophets used. It's the most popular name for God in the Old Testament. This is God's personal name. This is the name that shows him as separate from all other gods. To recognize which God we're talking about, you need to use this name. This is the name that Moses then used. And this is the name he took with him when he went down to Egypt. And this is the name that Jesus was using there in the first century, 1400 years later. Now, that's going to puzzle him, and he's going to decide he doesn't like that. We're going to see what your questions are concerning that. How much more time do we have?
1 minute.
1 minute. But folks, what I'm going to do today, we're going to unpack that name. We're going to look at that name. We're going to see why it's so important. And we're going to see why God chose that name. And we're going to see why the translators use the translations they use. And then we're going to come back to Jesus and see where that name is found elsewhere. Where we can find it elsewhere. After that, we're going to look and see what is the name that Moses would have heard in 1400 BC. And we're going to ask some questions of the Quran. We're going to ask some questions of the same incident that we find in Surah 20. But folks, after today, I hope all of you, especially Muslims, I expect you are listening to this debate. Because you're going to hear something, some of the things we're saying will not be pleasing. We know that. Other things that we say are going to be hard to understand. But folks, bear with us. I now give it over to you, and I ask you now, as a rebuttal, what are you going to do with Ego Amy in John 8:58?
Ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, I am not going to be able to exceed the lung power of the brother here, but I will try my best. Okay? The subject matter which Jay mentioned last month was, is there any definitive evidence of Jesus saying he is God? Basically, is Jesus God? From my perspective, usually one would have to consider the evidence that is available. Now, insofar as the evidence is concerned, obviously from my friend Jay's perspective, Jesus claims to be God in the Bible. The initial problem that I find with this particular contention of Jay is this. That's the very issue.
Just stop the clock, man. We are recording this. This will be up on YouTube. You can get it later on.
Thank you, brother. Yeah? The major issue that I have with the contention is this. That number one, there is no definitive statement attributed to Jesus explicitly claiming divinity in the Bible. There is not one. If there was, we wouldn't be having this discussion. Having said that, the other major problem I find is this, that of his own admission, my friend Jay has already stated that the Bible is corrupted. He himself made the admission here that the Bible has been changed. The question I would ask myself, you did say nobody should interfere, including yourself, I hope. Yeah? You see, at the end of the day, if you have made the admission that the information you are obtaining or extracting to formulate your conclusions is based on a book which you yourself have admitted is not entirely trustworthy, then it begs the question how it is that you are accepting what is contained within that book. But having said that, one asks oneself, the claim is being made that Jesus is God. On what basis is this claim being made? By our friend, it is being made on the idea that the term ego ami is somehow related to what was said in the book of Exodus chapter 3 verse 14. Ehya aser ehya. Okay, that is the contention that is being made. But is that all it is? Are we sincerely relating one particular phrase to mean that the whole of the book is claiming that Jesus is God? I would submit the answer is a definitive no. One of the things that we have to learn here is the principles that are attributed to hermeneutics. That is how you interpret things, okay? One of them is a basic one, yes? That if you have got something you are reading, if the literal element is the one that is making sense, yes? Then you should seek no other sense. In other words, if the verse is clearly telling you something, why do you want to twist it to suit the way you are looking at things? So I would suggest, for example, if I go to the book of Exodus 23 verse 13, we are told, if somebody has got a Bible and can pick it up please, we are told about how the Creator says, yeah, 23:13, as soon as you find it, let me know please. Have you got it? Thank you. Yeah? It says, be careful to do everything I have said to you. Do not invoke the names of other gods. Do not let them be heard on your lips. Now, Exodus 23:13 says, do not invoke any other gods. My question would be, okay, if I were to take the understanding of this, of Jesus being God, is this Jesus making the statement? Or is it God the Father? And if it is God the Father, is he also claiming that any other being that makes a claim to God is not to be considered? Does that include Jesus when he made the claim? Okay, this particular verse is explicit. Now, this is not only the verse. Isaiah 43 has got the same thing. The Creator is saying he is a jealous God. In what context is he? And if he is saying he is a jealous God, is this Jesus saying it, or is it God the Father saying it? And if it is God the Father saying it, what is the role of Jesus in this? Now, if this is going to lead to confusion, then I would submit to you that the principle should be kept in mind that what is literal ought to be considered rather than anything else.
Okay, thank you, Shabir. Let's go through what he is putting out. What he's saying is we have to have proper hermeneutics. And he's saying, and he invokes Exodus chapter 23, verse 13. Do not use any other name. Have you noticed Jesus has not used any other name? He was very clear. He was talking to Jews. He was talking in the temple. He was using Hebrew. The name that he used, Yahweh, or Ehye, Asher Ehye, is the word that he used. When he used Ehye, I am, as soon as he said that, he's not using any other name. If he had used Allah, then I would suggest he was using the wrong name. See, Exodus 23 verse 13 is very clear. You should also go to Deuteronomy chapter 18 verse 18, because the same thing is asked there, where God's name is in verse 17. Now you like to go to Deuteronomy because you like to go there to see what it says about Muhammad. Let's just open up Deuteronomy. Verse 18, I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren. You bring this to us all the time. The problem is you don't read the next verses. Which is this prophet from among the brethren? But then it says, and I will come to pass that I will, but I will not hearken unto the words which he shall speak in my name. Which name is he talking about? Look at verse 15, verse 17. The Lord. there's Yahweh. But the prophet who shall presume to speak in a word not my name, or sorry, to speak a word in my name which I have not commanded, or that speaks in the name of other gods, even that prophet shall die. I will take you up on that. Every prophet must speak in this name. And what is this name? Yahweh. Ehe. Asher Ehe. Any other prophet that speaks in another name, we must put to death. Don't just stop with verse 18. So what's the name your prophet brought? The name your prophet Muhammad brought is not Ehe. It is not Yahweh. In fact, you won't see that name anywhere in the Quran. But that's the name that all the prophets had to use to show that they were the prophets of this God. And why? Because it wasn't just the Father using it. In fact, it was Jesus that was using it in Exodus 3. If you have any doubts, open up to Exodus chapter 3. Let's just open up to Exodus. Do you have it in your hand? When you open up to Exodus chapter 3, start with verse 2. There was the angel of the Lord appeared to him. So who is this angel of the Lord? This angel of the Lord comes through over and over again right through the Old Testament. Look and see, verse 4. When the Lord, so this angel of the Lord is the Lord. When this angel of the Lord says, do not come any closer. Who's speaking here? The angel of the Lord, but verse 5 says, God said. So here this angel of the Lord is not only the Lord, he is God as well. And who is this person speaking? He is the one who is the Holy One. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, and the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. In Joshua chapter 5, verse 13 to 15, Numbers chapter 22, 31 to 32, we see the same thing repeated. And that's why, folks, when you look and see who's speaking here, this Ego Eimi is God himself. He is the angel of the Lord who comes to earth. And it's the angel of the Lord that you will see in Joshua 5. It's the angel of the Lord that you will see in Numbers 23 again. 22, sorry. And in every case, that's the second person of the Trinity. Now, it is Jesus, therefore, who is speaking to Moses. It is the same pre-Jesus, or the one who comes before Jesus, who is speaking at the temple in John 8:58. He is not using another name. Therefore, we do not put him to death. The Bible is not corrupted in this case. We pretty much all shown you that it is all consistent. All the way through it's consistent. But folks, that's not the only time we see Ego Eimi. All the way through in the Old Testament, you will see Ego Eimi over and over again. It comes up again in Deuteronomy 32, 39. See me now that I, even I, am he. There's the Ego Eimi again. Who's speaking? God speaking here. Isaiah 41, verse 4. I, the Lord. Did you get that? Should be it. The first and the last. Who claims to be the first and the last?
Jesus.
Jesus does. In Revelation chapter 1. Okay, quiet folks. So you have also Jesus. You have Jesus making the same claim in Revelation 1. That's it? That's 5 minutes?
Yeah, that's it.
I'm just getting started.
My friend here seems to respectfully confuse the issue. We are talking about whether Jesus made a definitive claim to be God. The answer still is no, and he hasn't provided any evidence to the contrary. Number one. Number two, he resorts to Exodus, and it is an odd one here, okay? The verse says, and this is what he had read, number four said, when the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush. Are we talking about one person or two persons? I would suggest two. If that is the case, it falls on to me to consider whether this particular verse again is talking about Jesus being the individual or the being. You see, Jay referred to verses in the Old Testament and said, look, here, Ego Eimi is being used again. Ego Eimi is being used again. I'm thinking, it wasn't in Greek though, was it? The Old Testament, as far as I'm aware, is not in Greek. So how is he superimposing a Greek text on something that even up to this day the scholars have not been able to establish or identify? For example, he referred to Ahia Asher Ahia, Ahia Asher Ahia. That is the ego ami, it is contended. Well, if that is the case, okay, Ahia Asher Ahia, what was the true name of God according to the Old Testament? I will wait for Jay to give me that answer in his response, okay? Because on that basis, we will be able to establish whether the phrase ego ami, which has been used many, many times in different contexts, does not necessarily mean it is divinity it is talking about. And we talked about hermeneutics. It is a simple one here. If there's a basic understanding, then that is what you must take first, unless you come across something you cannot understand. Now, I did mention the book of Exodus 23:13, and my friend Jay is contending that that is also Jesus. Well, there is no specific information claiming that, so we are left reliant on the interpretations of the people who claim that is the case. Jay also went into Revelation, and who is the Alpha and the Omega? It's the Creator. Well, who is the Creator? Jesus. Okay, that's fine. You want to believe that? I have no issue with that. But the evidence is not stating that. What I had requested, and I'm still requesting, any definitive evidence which cannot be interpreted in a multitude of ways, which is what we are going to get consistently, I'm afraid, for my friend Jay. Nothing specifically claims that he is what they claim he is, that he is God incarnate. Now, Jay also mentioned the Trinity in between. Here is an added element of confusion. Because if you are claiming Jesus Christ is a person of the Trinity, you are also making the admission that they are three separate entities. And if there are three separate entities, how can you definitively establish for me that the entity that spoke in Exodus 23:13 was Jesus? I would seek an answer from Jay in his rebuttal. Oopsie-daisy. Hey, have you given me a loose one here? Anyway, apologies.
Yeah? You need to be a little more stable.
I know.
Be stable like me.
Thankfully, the ladder isn't I am. But, oh, ego ami. Sorry, I didn't mean that. Okay? But if you think about it, just a joke. Yeah? If you think about it, it is very easy here. Jay has to definitively prove to me that Exodus 23:13, and that's one. I will be going into the others. Is definitively saying that it was Jesus God speaking there and not Father God. He has claimed about the Trinity, then I would humbly submit to him that he now needs to definitively tell me Exodus 23:13, it's not God the Father speaking, it is God the Son speaking. I will wait for him to give me a definitive response. Having said that, a bit further than that we go. If you go into Revelations, you go into the New Testament. The New Testament is based on what? On the Greek writings, okay? The Greek writings themselves will tell you certain facts. Ego ami has been used many a time. Yes? It doesn't necessarily mean just because ego ami was used, just I used it, I am stable, it doesn't make me suddenly God. Unless some very, very loving individual for me is going to make me God.
Okay. Now, did you hear him say that I said that Exodus 23:13 is Jesus? Did I ever say that? I didn't say that. Please don't quote me what I didn't say. God is speaking in Deuteronomy 18. Get it right. You can roll back the tape if you want to see. I didn't say that he's speaking there in Exodus 23. You're on shaky ground. You're going to fall off again. Deuteronomy 18 is very clear that God is speaking here. And he's speaking to Moses. And he's warning, like you see in Exodus 23 that you like to go to, that be careful of those who come in the name of other gods. That's the warning. And that's the warning we're giving all of you. Because we're saying much more than what he wants to say. These warnings are all through the Old Testament. The warning is, only trust when God speaks in his name. And that name is not Elohim, it's not Adonai, it is Yahweh. It is this name, Yahweh, that we're looking for. Ego Ami is nothing more than a translation in Greek. And it's also the translation that we see in the Septuagint. That's why we use the Septuagint, and that's why John, who was writing John chapter 8, verse 58, uses ego eimi, referring back to the Septuagint rendering, translation of the Hebrew. But as I said at the very beginning, Jesus was speaking Hebrew. So he would have used Ehye or Yahweh. That's the name that you will see all through the Old Testament. See, Adonai, we don't really think much about that name. That's a descriptive name for God. It's only found 300 times. We know that there is Elohim, which is a generic name for God, generic plural name for God, around 2,000 times. But the name that's by far the most important name, the name that everybody knew is God's unique name, God's holy name, God's personal name, Yahweh, that we see introduced here in Exodus chapter 3, verse 14. That name is found 6,823 times. We don't have time to go through all of them. Why is it that your prophet Muhammad did not know that name? And why is it that that name is not found in the Quran? And why is it that that name is not found in any of your traditions? In fact, I would suggest the reason why that name is not there is because your prophet never knew God. And the name he did use, we're going to unpack in a little bit. We're going to look and see who Allah really is. And we're going to see Allah is nothing like Yahweh. Allah, in fact, we're going to find, is incapable of doing what Yahweh could do. And your God in the Quran, the God that Muhammad introduced, or the God that Muhammad used, he didn't introduce it. This God, I don't recognize. That's why I love it when Jesus actually used the name Ego Eimi. Now, we could go to other things that showed why Jesus is God. We're sticking with Ego Eimi today because of the impact that that made on the Jews that were listening. The impact it made on the people right there who wanted to take up stones to stone him. Look at John chapter 18. John chapter 18. He brought it up again. When Jesus said, I am he was going to be arrested. They said, we're looking for Jesus of Nazareth. And he said, I am he. Ego eimi. The Jews fell back to the ground. They fell back and collapsed on the ground, these Jewish guards. Why? Because here a mere man was using God's holy name. Employing it, not just repeating it, not just speaking it, which no Jew could do. He was actually claiming it, and that's why they reacted the way they reacted. Folks, let's see if Allah can. We don't see Allah anywhere coming close to this kind of God. Because what does Ego Eimi mean? Or what does Yahweh mean? What does Ehye, Asher Ehye? Now, in the Septuagint, the Greeks have done a very interesting thing. The Greek scholars in the 2nd century BC, they didn't just say Ego Eimi twice. They went Ego Eimi Ha'an. Are you familiar with this?
Yes.
Ego Eimi Ha'an. Why did they put Ha'an there? Because when you're translating from the Hebrew into the Greek, if you just repeat Ego Eimi twice, I'm sorry, if you just repeat Ehye twice, as it was there in Exodus 3, for someone who was Greek would not understand that. That's why the Septuagint put Ego Eimi Ha'an.
10 seconds.
I am the being, or who is. We're going to unpack what that means the next time around, since I'm now out of time. But look at that, and understand that before you go any further. And then come back and tell me, where does Allah meet those credentials? I have my own.
I had asked Brother Jay to come back to some of the questions that I had asked, including Deuteronomy 18. Yes, I asked about the Lord and the God. I asked about Exodus 23:13. I didn't get anything that was shaky. Possibly for you it was.
I did answer.
Yes,
it.
But if I can, yeah. You see, it was simple. I asked, can you definitively tell me, and I will ask it again, can you definitively tell me that it is God the Father that's mentioned mentioned there, or is it God the Son Jesus? That's what I had asked, which I wait for you to answer. But going on what you said, you see, you have mentioned twice the Septuagint. Okay, you said the Greek form. They put ho on, you mentioned it, okay? Because in the original, it was repeated. The question is not that. The question is, and you also mentioned about how your prophet got it wrong, respectfully red herring, how the Quran respectfully red herring, because the issue is Jesus God? Now, it's simple. The Bible, and again, I'm going to repeat this consistently, definitively does not state anywhere that he made the claim. On the contrary, we have statement after statement which clearly says that he was not God. And we are going to address those. Going on what you say, you see, if you look at Exodus 3:14, and you mention it again, you talk about the unique name of God. Ehyeh, Asher, Ahiyah is what we have. Did Jesus ever mention any other name? Elohim, Adonai, anything else? You are contending Ego Ami. Yes? Is that a name? I don't think so. But let us take it a bit further, because the Gospel of Mark, and you are familiar with this, 12:29? Mark 12:29. Yes? We have got the Shema. Okay? Thank you. Yeah? But there are two that people use. Shema Israel. Adonai Elohinu Adonai Echad. Shema Israel Yahuwah Elo Yahuwah Echad. Now, I ask myself this question. If Jesus was not speaking Greek, as far as we are aware, he spoke Hebrew, when he uttered, as it is claimed in the Bible, when he uttered Shema Israel, Hear O Israel, Adonai Elohinu Adonai Echad, he himself rightly claimed Adonai is not one that we can really seriously consider. It's out. Adonai is out. So what is the name of God? That's what it says there. But it is for him to respectfully rebut what I am saying. Having said that, the question is this. Does Jesus ever make this claim definitively? We've already said no. So any verse that Jay is bringing up is merely subject to an extreme form of interpretation. When I talked about Deuteronomy 18, I asked you, it uses the word Lord and God. I contended there are two. And I said, well, if they aren't, please, Jay, come back to me. But I still want an answer to this before we move to those other verses. I want an answer to this. When those words are being said by God in the Old Testament, are you definitively saying to me, bearing the evidence in mind, that whenever God is speaking, it is actually Jesus, the Son God, speaking, or is it the Father God speaking? Which one is it? I would appreciate a response from Jay in his rebuttal. But he restricted himself to Ego Ami, Ego Ami. I'm sure he is aware, we are aware, that Ego Ami, and you did point it out, is used many a time in many different contexts. Yes? So what makes this particular use by Jesus in 8:58, which renders him from first a prophet to a son and now to a God? Definitive reasoning required. It is easy for us to interpret things the way we want them, but evidentially, we should have something which we can reasonably assess. Now, despite the effort of Jay to have Ego Emi fit into the Old Testament, he is signally failing. And the reason I say this is simple. Every time he uses a verse, I want to know from him, first and foremost, is that Jesus the Son part of the Trinity which he accepts, or is it the Father God who is speaking? Because if you are going to tell me it's Jesus the Son, then we have got something which we can move to. If you say it's the Father, you are in serious trouble. Well, actually, either way, you are in trouble.
There we go again. Can you see, he still hasn't answered my question. Why hasn't he answered my question? We'll come back to it again. You can see why he doesn't want to answer this question, because it's difficult for any Muslim to go beyond what exactly and who Allah is. But let's get back. You're talking about Mark, where Jesus quotes Yahweh Eloheinu Yahweh Echad. He's actually quoting Deuteronomy chapter 6 verse 4. There is the Shema in Deuteronomy 6 verse 4. And what is the word Yahweh Eloheinu Yahweh Echad? Yahweh is the name we're looking for. That's the name we've been talking about. Yahweh is Ego Eimi in the Septuagint. Yahweh is that personal name for God. Eloheinu is a generic name for God. It's repeated a second time to show the emphasis on Yahweh again. This means that it is the eternal name for God. And that's in Hebrew how they get eternality. So this God, Yahweh, is before, is present, and is yet to be. That's why you have Ego Hemi Ahaan in Exodus 3, chapter 3, verse 14. If you know your Hebrew, you will see that this is the eternality that God is using. Now, who is speaking here? That's the second person of the Trinity. Who is Jesus who is speaking? It is He who comes to earth. And He's He that is face to face with Moses. It is He that comes at Theophanies all the way through. We've already answered that. You keep bringing it up as if we haven't answered it. So every time you have God face to face with man, that is Jesus. And it is Jesus who then comes again at the very, in 2000 AD, I'm sorry, the first century AD, 2000 years ago, and spends 33 years on earth. That Jesus then claims to be God, not just once, just look at all the times. Let's just look and list. 10 times we can find right there in the book of John. John chapter 4 verse 26. Ego eimi, right there to the Samaritan woman. John chapter 6 verse 20. When the disciples were out on the sea and the sea was churning up. There He gives, it is I, to calm them down. And then what does He do next? He calms the sea and speaks to the storm. Now who can do that but God? Only God can calm the seas. We see that in Psalm chapter 107. And also, we see that also in Job chapter 9:8. He alone treads the waves of the sea and calms the storms. John 8:24. If you do not believe that I am He, you shall die in your sins. Folks, this is for all of you. If you do not believe that Jesus is claiming to be God right here, folks, we're all dead. So make sure you pay attention to what we're saying today. John 8:28. When you lift up the Son of Man, then you will know that I am. There it is again. We've already done about John 8, chapter 50, verse 58. John chapter 13, verse 9. When it does happen, you will believe that I am He. Referring back to Isaiah chapter 43, verse 10. That you may know and believe that I understand that I am He. This is God in the Old Testament, referred by Isaiah, referring again Jesus, quoting the same verse. John 18, verse 5. Jesus of Nazareth, they said, I am He. John 18, verse 6, we talked about earlier. When He repeated it, they fell to the ground because they realized He was saying, I am God. How many more times do you need? You want more? Go back to Mark chapter 6, verse 20. Go back to Matthew chapter 14. In every case, Jesus was using God's personal name, God's holy name, Yahweh. The only reason we say Ego Eimi, because that's the Greek translation. I know that's hard for you to understand. But folks, you all understand what we're saying here. Now, He has not answered who Allah is. So who in the world is Allah? What is this name? And is it a name? It just means the God. It's generic. Shabir, do you even know where this name comes from? Have you done any study on where this name comes from? And secondly, did Moses use that name? Did Moses use that name there in the burning bush? In Surah chapter 20, verse 10 to 14. Tell me if you really believe that Moses even knew Arabic. Was there any Arabic at the time of Moses in 1400 BC? And if Allah is not God's name, then why in the world are you following the Quran? You've got the wrong God. You've got to come back to what really happened in 1400 BC. And the only way I know to do that is come back to the testimony of God Himself, Jesus, there with Moses. Now answer those questions.
Right. First and foremost, the questions still have not been answered. Now, if J is actually claiming what I just heard him saying, that the one who turned up in the burning bush was Jesus. That's the claim he made. Okay, fine. He also made the claim that right through the Bible, it was Jesus who came. So what happened to God the Father then? I need to know. Consistently, the same problem is arising, and respectfully referring to who Allah is, well, the subject matter is not, is Jesus Allah? It isn't. It is Jesus God? Okay?
No, it is Allah God.
If I can, yeah? So you see, Jay, despite his effort, is still failing in answering the principal questions. Now, he also mentioned some very odd issues time and again, and I didn't pull him up on it. I was hoping that he would drop it, but he didn't. Okay? He kept on mentioning the Septuagint version. Was there something before the Septuagint? Please do tell us in your rebuttal. Because if there was, I would want to know what it was that it contained which the Septuagint has changed. Because, and I'm sure he's aware of the history of these particular books, okay? Where changes have taken place, one needs to know why they took place. I would respectfully submit to all of you that the claim that Jesus is God is an entirely subjective belief devoid of the evidence that is available. It is simple. There is a serious problem when it comes to understanding how we arrived at where we have arrived. The idea that a man walking the earth being God in itself is illogical completely, because one would say, okay, fair enough, I am of a particular kind of outlook, and I do believe that the goat that is stood next to me is God incarnate. Why can it not be? Okay, the other thing, and this has been actually addressed many a time even with Jay, that if you look at the whole of the Bible, as he rightly screams out, from Genesis to Revelation, does it specifically restrict the Trinity to three? No, it doesn't. So the question still arises. If Jay is confidently telling me, and I'll believe what he says, if he is confidently asserting that any time God is mentioned in the Old Testament, it is Jesus, then he has rightfully killed off the Father, which is expected. But having said that, it still is not definitive evidence that Jesus is God. You have to strain your interpretation to try and fit it, which you are entitled to do as a belief, no problem. But factually speaking, still nothing has been brought. For him to then turn around and say, why in the Quran does Allah, do you know this? Well, we are talking about Jesus, let's restrict it. As it is, you are confused respectfully before you go to something else. Having said that, all I am asking, and I'll ask again, the verses are all there. You have resorted to some of them. Just because the word, and I want you to answer this definitively so that we can make a step, a progress of some kind. Whenever ego ami is used in the New Testament, is it definitively claiming that whoever made that or whoever said that is claiming divinity? It's a yes or a no answer. If you think that is straining it, I don't mind, please tell me. But every time Jesus used words, and he is aware, although he did make a slight error, Jesus spoke in Hebrew or a form of Hebrew. It certainly wasn't Greek. And if you are going to contend it was Greek, then we need the evidence for it. So when it is translated from the Septuagint, because he mentioned it specifically, I would want to know from him, was there something that the Septuagint was translated from? And if it was, what did that contain in terms of the statements? That is what I would want to know. Jesus Christ came. He made simple statements. These are common amongst everybody. I'll use the most common one, John 5:30. I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just because I seek not my will, but the will of him that sent me. Now, if Jay is claiming it's God Jesus all the way through, then what? Am I to even remotely suggest here that one is being delusional, either the statement maker or Jay? I know which one I think it is. But having said that, the statements are very clear.
Time up.
Thank you.
It's been long up, hasn't it? let's go again.
No, respectfully, this is not fair. You have just accused him of having just extended the time, Jay.
He just happened to look down. Was it maybe 5 minutes? Let's go ahead. Have you noticed he asked a lot of questions, but he hasn't answered our question yet? He still has a problem of dealing with Allah. Would you all like to know who Allah is?
Yeah.
Would you like to know where he came from? Would you like to know if this is God's holy name? Because we are talking about God's holy name, aren't we? Now suddenly they don't want us to talk about it. He mentioned, interestingly, keep your Muslims down, keep your Muslims in control. Isn't it interesting that he says it would be odd for God to come to earth? That would be odd for God to come to earth. I agree, it would be odd for God to come to earth. Are you suggesting that God cannot come to earth? Please don't say that in my presence. If your God cannot take on human form, you don't have God. Your God is too small. If your God is incapable of coming to earth and taking on human form, what kind of God do you have? Get a bigger God. Come on home, we've got him. And his name is Jesus. Yes, my God can come on earth anytime he wants. And every time he came to earth, and he did right through the Old Testament, that was God who was talking to Moses in Deuteronomy. We're having a debate. That was God right through the Old Testament that was face to face with Moses. My God can come to earth from the very beginning. He was in the Garden of Eden, talking with Adam and Eve, walking and talking in the cool of the day. We've already answered this. You keep bringing it up because you don't like this answer. Because your God is too small. If your God can only remain totally distant, totally other, without any name, and that's the problem really. He doesn't want to talk about the name of God. Allah is not a name. Allah is nothing more than a generic title. In fact, we now know where Allah comes from. We're going to show you what we now know about Allah. Folks, can you see why he wants to keep this on Jesus? Jesus clearly used God's name over and over again. Jesus was God in the Old Testament. It was every time anybody talked to man face to face, that was Jesus. Of course, there is other times that God also spoke, but always through the prophets. Now that's why we need to make sure that when we see when Jesus did come 2,000 years ago, he not only carried that name, Muhammad didn't know that name. It is not in your Quran. You've got the wrong God, and your God is incapable of coming to earth. And that's why we're introducing this today. Now we need to go back and look and see where Allah does come from. Where would you guess? See, they don't even know where
that's
he comes from. Is it the only name for God? Is Allah that his only name? And when you go back and look and see the antecedents for Allah, you will find that it is a Nabataean God. It is a pagan God. The Nabataean God, remember, Arabic got the script of Arabic from Nabataean. And see, even the Muslims are now surprised at hearing this. They have no idea that Allah did not exist prior to the 4th century AD. But that's not his only name. He's also known as Dushara, the Lord of the Shara. Hold on, folks, it gets worse. Okay. Allah, the Nabataean God, the pagan God, known as Ilaha, La Ilaha, from which Allah is derived, has a wife named Alat, which is a feminine form of Allah. Now in your Quran, in Surah 6, Ayah 101, it says God does not have a consort. Then what in the world do you using Allah for? Because Allah does have a consort. And her name is Alat. Her other name is Aluza, which is her title. And then there's Al-Manat, who is the goddess of Hegra. Can you notice what I've just said? Alat, Al-Manat, and Aluza? That's found in your own Quran, in Surah 53, Ayah 19 and 20, known as the Satanic Verses. Folks, do you see what, if you just do a little bit of scratching, if you look at a little bit of history, the very God they have in their Quran is a pagan God, a polytheistic God, who has a wife, possibly a daughter. This God is not the God of the Bible. This God didn't even exist prior to the Nabataean creation of her. But more than that, folks, can you now see? If in Surah 20, verse 10 to 14, If that is Allah speaking to Moses, whoever wrote Surah 20, folks, and I don't think it's Moses, I'm sorry, I don't think it's Muhammad, and I don't think that's Moses hearing this, did not know God's personal name, did not know God's holy name. Because that name every prophet should use. So how could Muhammad be a prophet if he doesn't know God's holy name? Answer that.
Do you know Arabic?
Finish.
Time, brother.
Start the clock, brother.
Yes.
Thank you. There you go. Now, despite, and I commend Jay again, yes, I did say just before I finished that either the speaker in the Bible was delusional or respectfully Jay. In this particular instance, he's trying his best to divert the subject matter, but I understand why. Yeah, at the end of the day, it is impossible to prove that Jesus made the claim to divinity in the Bible. It cannot be done. That is why Jay is straining. Having said that, he made a very interesting observation, I have to admit. He said, your God is not that powerful. Words to that effect. He cannot come down as a man. Well, actually, I had mentioned a goat. So I would want to know, is it possible for his God to come down as a goat? If the answer is no, there is a serious problem here. And I don't mean this in a flippant way at all. Yes? Because if his God is big enough, then he can come down as a goat. And if that is the case, Jay should not have a problem, just a slight diversion here, Jay should not have a problem at all in considering God coming down as a cow, or as a horse, or as anything else. I know Jay will not accept that, nor will all my Christian brethren. It is impossible to conceive of something like this. However, he did mention himself when he tried to desperately bring the Quran into the discussion. Okay, it is simple. There seems to be a history to this understanding that our Christian brethren have arrived at. And that is what needs to be considered, because honestly, I asked again and again, and he claims he's answered it, and I was very specific in my words. I made it very clear to him, when God spoke in the Old Testament, again, in the Old Testament, Jay, was that Jesus the Son or was it God the Father? It's a simple question, and I know it is not beyond your intellect here, respectfully.
I have answered it, did I not?
Can I finish? Yes? It's simple. You ask me, I would have to, if this is the position I take, I would say, no. This is God, this is Jesus God speaking to Moses. If that is the case, then God the Father is completely out of the Bible, because that is the contention you are making. And if that be the case, then we have a serious problem with the Trinity also. Now, it is related, because Jesus is allegedly a part of the Trinity. If you look at the verses themselves, I did ask Jay to also clarify for me, which for some odd reason he forgot and decided to jump on the Quran. I said to him, was there another prior writing or a set of writings from which the Septuagint was translated? I want to know so that we can have a better understanding of the words used. You know, he talked about the 858, the I am. Ego Ami, okay? But Jay is fully aware, I'm sure some of my Christian friends here are also aware, that the actual translation is not definitive of that phrase. Yeah, you have got people saying, I am the being versus I am that I am who I am. There's a whole host of them. So on what basis have we established that is what Jesus actually meant according to the Bible, despite the fact that we know he would not have used ego ami. That is the translation of whatever he used. Obviously, Jay finds it funny and I agree with him. It is funny. That is why we are having this confusion. But having said that, if you look at the verses themselves, how are you equating divinity to him from one verse, adding the other verses? Look, he said, I am here. He said, I am there. Well, there were others who also said, I am. Did that make them divine? He will say, no. The question is, why? Why the distinction between the two? Why is it emphatic, as it was said? And last month, when I was speaking to them, my dear sister, yeah, she said, oh, look, there was the exclamation. Oh, well, that didn't wash water. But having said that, I want Jed to answer us these questions. I also mentioned the fact that Jesus Christ said, I, with the finger of God, cast out devils. Luke 11:20. When he says that, when Acts 2:22, common verses I'm relying on, and I haven't gone to the others, which I will. Common verses like Jesus Christ, a man approved of God by miracles, wonders, and signs, which God did through him. Now the question is, which God? Jesus or Father? Again, I want him to answer.
Time up.
Okay. Folks, did I not answer this many times already?
No.
Have I not arisen? See, the Muslims are not listening. We will say it again. Stop the clock. Stop the clock. Okay. Now start it again. Have you noticed? I've said it now not once, not twice, but three times. Every time God comes to earth and speaks to man, that is Jesus. But that doesn't mean that all the other references to God does not preclude or eradicate the Father. Let me just give you an example in Exodus 33. Here, Moses is talking to God face to face, the Lord. There's that name we're looking for, Yahweh. And he says to Moses, the Lord spoke to Moses face to face as a man speaks to his friend. He says, I want to see the Lord. The God says to him, you cannot see his face, for no one may see me and live. Then the Lord said, there is a place near me where you may stand on a rock. When my glory passes by, I will put you in the cleft of the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand and you will see my back, but my face must not be seen. Hold on a minute. In verse 11, he's speaking to God face to face. You have two persons of the Trinity in the same scenario. One is God the Father, one is God the Son. They both are called the Lord. See, deal with it. You may not like that answer, but that's why the Bible is so consistent all the way through. More than that, you asked, what was there and what was happening in John chapter 5, verse 30? When he says, I'm about ready to leave, he says, in John chapter 5, 30, previously he is equal to God the Father in verse 18. And then yet you're saying that how can he do something separate from God? Listen, look at the unity, because whenever Jesus does work, he does in unity with God the Father and the Holy Spirit. You can see, if you read the verses that come before, he was equal to the Father in verse 18. He gives life in verse 21. He judges in verse 22. Yes. Has equal honor with God the Father in 23. He has unity with God in verse 30. That's the second part of the verse that you're even asking. So yes, Jesus does work in unity with God the Father and God the Son. He works through the power of the Spirit while he is on earth. He can come to earth and go again many times. Remember, we have many instances in the Old Testament where God came to earth. He was there walking and talking in the cool of the day. He was there wrestling with Jacob. He was with Abraham eating in front of the tent of Mamre in Deuteronomy 18. But see, your God is incapable of doing that. And Allah of the Quran never comes to earth. Have you noticed that? Allah of the Quran is so distant, so other, that he can't even answer. He dare not go to see who this Allah is. Have you noticed? He is still not answering my question. He refuses to talk about Allah. He knows that he doesn't know much about Allah. Because Allah is not a name. It's nothing more than a generic title. The God. We're still waiting for the name of God, that holy name, that universal name, that name that is the beginning, the present, and the end, that God did use and that all the prophets used to delineate the God that is the holy, the unique God. Allah is nothing more than a pagan God. I'm saying it again, folks. You're not going to get an answer to him. He asked, can God come as a goat? Yes, he could. He could come any way he wanted. But he doesn't come as a goat. He didn't need to. He said at the very beginning in Genesis 3, when Adam and Eve had not only sinned against God, he turned to them and he said, from your line, where's a woman here? There's a woman there. From your line, it has to be a woman's line. He, that means it's going to be a male, third person singular, is going to come and crush Satan's head. and Satan's going to bruise his heel. He already said that he was going to come. It's going to have to be a male, and it's going to have to come through a woman. It has to come through some woman. But what woman? Isaiah tells us who this woman is. In Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, that this woman is going to be a virgin. Now, you know, Muslims, there's been only one virgin that's ever had a child in the history of mankind. And what's her name? Her name is Mary. So 800 years before Jesus was born, Isaiah already said where this one is going to come, that is going to be God himself, who is going to come through a virgin, not a male, but through a woman's line, and that he is going to come and destroy death. That's why God had to come. Not as a goat, please. As a man. Because this is what he promised from the very beginning. That he would come from a man from the very beginning, but through a woman who is a virgin. And there's only one man that I know that comes through a woman's, and that is Jesus Christ. God himself, who is able to come to earth anytime he wants. Come on home to that God, folks. Because that's the God you're missing.
Time's up.
Thank you. Going back to our friend, like I said, despite his constant effort in trying to divert the subject, I am not going to go there. But the subject matter is simple. Is Jesus God? That's the question that is being answered. Now, Jay refers to certain things.
Are we going to have guys yelling at me? Okay. Jay, just keep it down.
Stop the clock. Jay, you're Christian, the Christian brother.
Which
there,
Christian is yelling?
There.
Who?
Okay, these brothers are constantly. That's why.
They're not to speak, please. Otherwise, they're going to come on there, okay?
No, it's only fair. And I would ask my Muslim brothers again.
Start again from the beginning.
Yeah? No. Just start it where you are. Okay. You know what? Go. Jay. This at last is making a bit of progress. He has actually addressed certain things, but again, I think there's a selective memory loss here. I did specifically ask Jay, Exodus 33, yeah, I went there, yeah, 23:13, sorry, yes, and I said, is that Jesus God? Or is it Father God? He kindly stated in his response, he said, well, some places, yes, it says it's Jesus, but there are others where, you know, part of the Trinity comes into effect. That's progress, because I was specific about what I had asked. When I talked about John 5:30, excuse me, I asked very simply, when he says that, I can of my own self do nothing, as I hear I judge. Jay is claiming that is a part of the Trinity, okay? Now, here, the verses you read, a distinction is being made in John 5, yes? It says to me here, if I go to verse 22, moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. That particular, and going across, okay? Here, a distinction is being made between two persons. That is agreed. The question I'm asking is that, if God the Father, Jesus, God the Son, are present, I am asking, in Exodus 23:13 and amongst other places, definitively, is that God the Father? Or is that Jesus God? Now, unfortunately, Jay also went on to suggest that what is the problem with God coming down as a goat? But he won't come down as a goat. Why not? If he wanted to, he can. Now it opens up, you know what they call the flood waters here, okay? So he can come down as a chicken, yeah? No problem. And he will peck us to death. No, it's silly at its outset, okay? But unfortunately, and I don't blame Jay, he believes in it. The evidence he knows is contrary to what he's believing, but he is now stuck. He can't do a thing about it. Having said that, I will ask again. that when Jesus Christ makes this distinction, and I did raise the book of Acts chapter 2 verse 22 also, yes, a man approved of God by miracles, wonders and signs which God did through him. Now, we know, and it has been often quoted by so many Muslims also, if you go to the book of Job chapter 25 verse 4 to 6, where the Son of Man is considered to be a worm and the rest of us maggots. Is that what Jesus is? Well, according to Jay's reasoning, he can be a worm. If God can come down as a man and as a goat, he can come down as a maggot. It is getting ridiculous now. And it is. Logic and reason clearly are against what is being suggested. However, I will shift it because I know Jay is not going to be able to answer the questions, because if he does, he will condemn himself. Nevertheless, we will have to move forward. No definitive answer about Jesus making a definitive claim to divinity. According to Jay's own admission, the Bible is corrupted. So it's stretching the imagination again as to why it is being relied upon as evidence for his contentions. But the story doesn't end there. There seems to be something that has led to this conclusion that my friend Jay has held. Jesus Christ being elevated from a mighty prophet to a son of God, and from then on to a divine, in fact, the divinity itself. There is something that happened. Now I'm sure Jay is going to be aware, and the evidence is unfortunately not there to favor him. But Jay will be aware that many councils had sat. What we call, you know, this father-son relationship that he talked about. Yes? The hypostatic union we talk about.
10 seconds.
Okay, are you familiar with this? Well, I will take on to the next one. But I just want Jay to admit, Deuteronomy 23:13. Was it God the Father explicitly, or was it Jesus the Son, the Father?
Okay, very quickly, we've already answered Deuteronomy 23:13. God's not speaking there, is he? Are you suggesting God's speaking there? Let me read it. Be careful, do everything I have said to you. Do not invoke the names of other gods. Do not let them be heard on your lips. Who's talking here? Moses is talking here, right? Is this Moses speaking or God?
Okay.
No, what is it? No, tell me, what is it?
Is it Moses?
It's Moses speaking here.
Okay.
So Moses is referring that nobody's to take the name of God.
Excellent.
There you go. It's Moses speaking. He is writing here. These are his five books.
Excellent.
So now we've subjected to that. Now, this idea that if God can become a goat, he can become anything else. Why is it that you have a problem with that? Please stop limiting God. See, the problem with Muslims is they always want to limit God. You don't believe that God could take on any form he wants. My God can, why can't yours? The fact that he cannot suggests to me that your God is nothing more than a pagan God. The fact is that my God does not take on any form but as a man. Because that's what he came to do. That's what he promised to do. That's exactly what he did. And then as fast as, what far is he saying that he did claim to be God? Every time that he claimed and invoked the name of God, he is God. Do you all believe that? See, they don't have a problem. The Muslims have a problem with that. You don't like the fact that Jesus made this claim. And the reason you don't like it is because Muhammad never made this claim. Muhammad could not make this claim. No other could make this claim. Only God could make the claim of divinity, which he did over and over again. He did things that only God could do. Let me give you some examples. He was able to calm the waves. I made that one already. He was able to stop the storm. I made that already. He was able to also give righteousness. It says that he was able to forgive sins in Mark 2, verse 5 to 7, to the paralytic. Something only God could do, Jesus was able to do. There's another way that he showed he was God. He was able to give resurrection of the life when he was talking to Martha. He was able to answer prayers in John 14. He was able to receive prayers in John 14, verse 14, Acts 1, verse 24 to 25. He also knew men's thoughts, something only God can do. We see this in John 4, 18. We see this in Matthew 12, 25. There are many other cases where Jesus was able to know men's thoughts. Could Muhammad do that? Could any other man do that? Nobody could do that but Jesus. Which shows you in everything he did, in what he said, he was being God. Now, there are many people that can say, I am, but that's always with a predicate. When he said that without a predicate, that's when Jesus was claiming divinity. And every one of these 10 ones that I gave as example, he says it without a predicate. And that's why the Jews knew what he was up to. Now, where did Allah make this claim? Where is this Allah we're looking for? And why is it this name that you're all about, the one, the name that is his divine name, can still not be found anywhere in Islam? I would suggest, folks, that the Muslims have to attack Jesus Christ because they know that he is greater than anything they've come across. See, Muhammad could not do what Jesus did. You notice, Muhammad could not forgive sins. Muhammad can't even do a miracle. Yet Jesus did miracles. Right there in Surah 3, Ayah 49, making birds out of clay, blowing onto them. I don't believe that happened, but it's in the Quran. Giving sight to the blind, healing the sick, resuscitating the dead. Where can anybody do that? And see, for the Muslims, they have a problem here. Because they want to demote Jesus and elevate Muhammad and say he is the greatest of all prophets. Folks, Muhammad a prophet? Where did he even claim? In fact, let me ask you this. How could he be a prophet? He's not in the prophetic line. What did he prove? What did he do to prove he was a prophet? You see, every prophet either has to do a prophecy or has to do a miracle. Jesus could do this easy. In fact, all the prophets could do this. Why could Muhammad not do this? More than that, folks, can you see why he has to attack Jesus' divinity? Because Jesus was doing things only God could do. Nowhere do we find anybody but God forgiving sins. Even the Pharisees realized this when he forgave the sin of the paralytic. And they saw that this is something only God can do. And there was Jesus doing that very thing. He speaks with a divine authority. It is he who gives us the whole new covenant in Matthew 5. It is he who gives us a whole new law in Matthew 5.
10 seconds.
Only God can do that. And yet Jesus does that. And he is that one the temple bows down to. He is the Lord of the Sabbath in Matthew chapter 12.
Time's
show
up.
Me, Muhammad,
Time's
anything like this. In fact, show me where Allah can do these things. Back okay. to you.
I think Jake... I think Jake...
Can you answer his questions as well?
They're getting upset because you're not answering my questions.
Control your questions.
Go ahead. Answer my questions.
Okay. Going back to the subject matter, okay? It is simple. Jay, at last we have made progress. And I'm glad we have. Okay? Apart from your red herrings again, yes? We stick to the subject matter.
And
here is what will happen. Yeah? I referred you to Exodus, and you have pointed out, well, this is what Moses is talking about God. Okay, no problem. So, how do we deal with Exodus chapter 20 verse 8, where it says, I the Lord am a jealous God. Yeah? Is that God the Father or is that Jesus God? Please answer that in your rebuttal. Okay, now that's specific. So I'm sure you'll be able to answer that.
Exodus 20 verse 8.
Yeah, if you in your rebuttal you can tell me, is that God the Father or is that Jesus God? But going a bit further, as I said, you see, there seems to be a history to this very, and I say this respectfully, this very odd belief that God can come down as an ant, as a maggot, as a man, as a goat, whatever. It is odd. But that is not the issue. The issue here is this. What does Jesus say? Because that is the contention being made that Jesus is God. Jesus says, I can of my own self do nothing, in John 5:30. But interestingly, Jay points out, Jesus was able to do this, Jesus was able to do that, Jesus was able to do this. Well, the Bible, and I've already referred to it in the book of Acts chapter 2 verse 22, makes it very, very clear. Hear, O Israel, Jesus Christ, a man approved of God by miracles, wonders, and signs which God did through him. Now, Jay's interpretation of this verse seems to be God, Jesus, through God, Jesus did it. That's how it's coming across. But he's going to have to answer it. Yeah?
Can I have a tissue, please?
Yeah, he's going to have to answer it. Is that what it's saying? Well, if it is, okay, it is simple. Jesus Christ is a mighty messenger of God. Thank you very much. It's so logical that I find it very odd that for a person like my friend Jay here, for him to miss it completely is quite mystifying, but we'll get to the mystery later. You see, if you find it this way, you also find in John chapter 11 verse 41, which I often repeat, yes, Jesus Christ says, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me. Question, what did he ask for? Any Christian, tell me here. Jay, I will leave it for him to tell me. Okay? The answer has to be given, because it seems Jesus Christ asked for something, and whatever he asked was granted. I know that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me. Now, you must understand that for you to have an understanding, you look at the principles that are very clear of hermeneutics, that where you have a literal understanding, that is the most sensible. Don't look for any other kind of understanding. Having said that, here is what I am saying. Okay, if Jesus Christ said, I thank you that you have heard me, I know that you always hear me, but because of the people that stood by, I said it so that they may believe, you have sent me. He that is sent cannot be greater than he that sent him. Now, these are the words of Jesus. Obviously, he'll have a twist on it, but that's up to him. Having said that, when Jesus Christ is asking, and Acts 2:22 is saying, a mighty messenger of God, which the Creator used as a mouthpiece, no logical individual will be able to misunderstand that or disagree with. But does that necessarily mean that the person who was chosen as a mouthpiece now becomes divine? I would suggest and submit, no, that is not the case. Going back to what I am saying, there seems to be a history here of how we have arrived at this understanding. I touched on it the last time. What is the amount of time?
You got 41 seconds.
41 seconds. I'll hold it. Okay? There is a history which I'm going to touch upon, because it's patently obvious that the verses that we are referring to in the Bible in no way can ever indicate that Jesus is claiming divinity. It is an impossible task which my brother is trying, and I commend him for it, and signally failing, because it isn't there. Had it been there, all the scholars of the world, who even now, going back to what he said about this name, even now cannot definitively tell you what Ehia Asarahia is. They cannot definitively tell you. And if they cannot definitively tell you, how in the world have you said Ego Ami is what it says there? Now, what I would suggest we do is look... Sorry, I'll stop.
Okay. Listen, I'll move on. It's been an hour, but listen, can we go on now to the historical critique after this?
No, we'll need to finish now.
I told you we'll finish this topic, and then if you choose that one, we'll do it again next time.
The same thing.
No, I didn't say that.
I'm going to do that one today as well.
It wouldn't be fair, because I did tell you we have to travel 200 odd miles. So you can come back next week, or no, 3 weeks, then we'll do that.
Don't, that in every case when Jesus did use God's holy name, which only God can use, which only God would use, in every case, the Jews who did not accept Jesus, remember, they did not like Jesus, they were not at all friends with Jesus. They picked up stones to stone him. They fell to the ground in John 18. The reaction of the Jews showed you that Jesus did use that name. He not only claimed to be God, but then he did things to prove that he was God. He was able to forgive sin. He was able to control nature. He was able to do that which God could only do. He was able to even know men's thoughts.
Yes.
What Sabir has done doing today has been doing an awful lot of ad hominem. I've been careful not to do ad hominem with him. He's done a very good debate. That's fine. But much of what he has been going on today is trying to discredit what I'm saying just by yelling at me and saying, you're not convincing anybody. But you're all convinced, aren't you?
Yeah.
There you go. See, you haven't convinced these guys. And have you noticed that he will not support Allah? He cannot support Allah. If we're talking about God's name, how can we use a name that is not only generic, but did not exist prior to the 4th century AD, and more than likely did not even exist prior to the 7th century AD in Arab sources?
That's why I want to ask again, you Muslims, be careful. Because everything you're dependent on is on a God who is incapable of coming to earth. My God can come to earth anytime he wants. But why did he come to earth? He came to earth to save us from our sins. He came to earth to die on the cross. He came to earth to give you a free gift. He came to earth to die and rise again. He came to earth to destroy death. He is the King of Kings. He is the Lord of Lords. He is God in heaven. He is God on earth. He is God on the cross. He then rose again. He now is in heaven. He waits for you and me. He wants to bring him home. And what is his name?
Jesus.
What is his name?
Jesus.
What is his name?
Jesus.
Oh, I love that God.
Don't debate anyone, just make a show.
So, man, you're not convinced, but they're convinced. And those of you who are watching this on TV, those of you who are watching it up on YouTube, are you convinced? Because if you're not convinced, that's what you're going to have to live with for the rest of your life. But someday God is going to ask you, do you know my son? Do you know who Jesus is? Do you accept what he did on the cross for you? It doesn't cost you a thing. All you have to do is give your life to Jesus Christ. He is God. He has done only things God can do. And he is offering every one of you who is watching this eternal life. You can be with God walking and talking and again. You can actually be with God for eternity because of what Jesus did. And only God could do what Jesus did. Only God can die on the cross and eradicate your sin. He promised he would do it. He came and did it. Allah cannot do any of that. Get the right God. Come on home to Jesus Christ. Come on home to what he did for you. Folks, I invite you. Come and see us. Talk to us. See Shabir. But folks, be careful what Shabir is saying. He cannot at all defend his God. He has not even been able to talk about Allah today. What a hopeless defense that is. That's the one Adam ad hominem I'll say today. Folks, it is the God of the New Testament, the God of the Old Testament, who comes to earth all the way through, who is the God who died on the cross and rose again. And he is the God that can give you eternal life.
Hallelujah.
It doesn't cost you a thing.
Come on.
I welcome you home. Over to you, Shabir.
Thank you.
I'm going to shoot up.
All right. Okay. We need a 5-minute counter.
Just do one more 5 minutes.
Last 5 minutes. Okay. We are on the last one. Yeah, just start with the 5.
Okay.
Right. Brothers and sisters, the first thing I may say, if I have said anything untoward, please do forgive me. That was not the intention. It was in the context of the discussion, debate that I was having with Jay. As far as the ad hominems, as he claims, are concerned, I did make it very clear. I humbly say this because there's a clear confusion on Jay's part. Okay, in terms of the discussion, in the subject matter.
We're still friends.
Of course we are. Yeah? But going to what he said, I did ask evidence again. I asked, okay, go to Exodus 28 and tell me, God the Father or Jesus the Father or Son? It's a bit confusing. But I left it to him. He never touched it. I said, okay, Acts 2:22 clearly says Jesus Christ, a man approved of God by miracles, wonders and signs. We have no problem with that. But do you have a problem with the Creator telling him to do things and the Creator accepting and doing what Jesus is requesting as a prophet? I don't have a problem with that. But here is the issue. I will contend this for my Christian brethren especially to try and understand this. You see, Jay talked about his belief to which you rightfully, emotionally attached yourself to. But the evidence itself is giving you a totally different picture. And I'll leave you with this thought in mind. The development of the Trinity came as a result of many councils, which he is aware of. Yes? And one particular council in 451 AD, they formulated what you would call the understanding behind the Trinity. Now, I'm going to read it out, and I want any of my Christian friends, including Jay, to explain this to me. Okay? I'm going to start the quote here. The Trinity and its understanding, how have you arrived at it? Father, Son, and Holy Ghost Is it as simple as that? No, unfortunately it isn't. Here is what they said. In 451...
Sorry? It's as simple as that.
Yeah. It is as simple as that. I hope so too. But let's have a look. It says, and I quote, "We then, following the Holy Fathers, all with one consent, teach men to confess one and the same Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, the same perfect in Godhead and also in manhood, truly God and truly man, of a reasonable soul and body, consubstantial with the Father according to the Godhead, and consubstantial with us according to the manhood, in all things like unto us without sin, begotten before all ages of the Father according to the Godhead, and in these latter days for us and for our salvation, born of the Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, according to the manhood, and one and the same Christ, Son, Lord, only begotten, to be acknowledged in two natures, inconfusedly, unchangeably, indivisibly, inseparably, the distinction of the natures being by no means taken away by the union, but rather the property of each nature being preserved and concurring in one person and one subsistence, not parted nor divided into two persons, but one and the same Son, the only begotten God, the Word, the Lord Jesus Christ, as the prophets from the beginning have declared concerning Him, and the Lord Jesus Christ has taught us, and the creed of the Holy Father has handed down to us." Any Christian here who can, in a nutshell, explain this to me, I will give you a free drink. But I know, it's so easy. It's not right.
It's hard for him.
Yeah. So it is so simple. At the end of the day, the fact that my Christian brethren are getting emotional is touching a raw nerve. I accept. Okay. But here, the truth of the matter is simple. Jay did talk about his belief, which he's entitled to, but when it came to the evidence, he point blank refused to assess the evidence as it was requested of him. I gave him opportunity after opportunity, and the fact that now my friend Jay is laughing is confirmation of that fact. But I would suggest to my Christian friends, Jesus Christ said it very clearly, Shema Israel, Adonai Elohinu, Adonai Ehud. The Lord, your God, the Lord Elah is one. Deuteronomy 6:4, Moses said the same thing. If you notice, and you take the version that Jay restricts himself to, Yahuwah Elo, Yahuwah Ahud. Yes? You take that and you find, Huwa Elo, Huwa Ahad. Kul Huwallahu Ahad. Say, your Lord is one. I invite you to Islam and come to the right path instead of the respectfully confused way. Thank you. Takbir!
I say, Yahweh, Huwa Al-Akbar!
Yahweh is the greatest!
Hallelujah! There's God's name there as well. God bless you, folks. It's been a good debate.
A pleasure. Thank you very much.
Next time, how did Islam begin?
Okay.
When are you coming back?
What, the origins of Islam?
The origins of Islam.
Okay, no problem.
When?
It's going to be either in
1 month.
Yeah, in 1 month.
Okay.
Because I'm due to leave the country, and if that happens, then it'll be after the month of Ramadan.
Okay, what, July?
Okay. Yes, in July.
Who's in charge of your calendar?
There he is, the handsome man.
5th of June.
No, if I can, I'm due to be out of the country, so I don't know. But can we confirm it with you? Can we take exchange of address? Yeah, give me your email.
Everybody stay here, we're gonna continue.
To see more videos like this, subscribe to Titans TV down below. Thanks. The greatest darkie, that bite with shark teeth and hate malarkey. Who you? The greatest heartbeat.
ancient Egypt as a matrix.
No, 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 la, la, la. Yehudi.
So,
no, no, Jewish.
He's a Jew.
La ilaha illallah, Musa or Rasulallah.
That's where everybody get bust up. You know, you remember Mike Tyson? You get bust up, you go in the Quran if you want to try to find shirk, because he's not present. Allah Ta'ala says, and you remember the Quran. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Qul huwallahu ahad. Allahu samad. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad.